I'm going to attempt something today I've never done, but I'm looking forward to it. The reason we got a little different schedule today, I'll be going over to Green Acres to preach, which that's nothing new, but I will preach here twice and Green Acres once. Then I'm going to jump in the car right after the second service and drive to Martinsville. I'm preaching at a revival tonight. So I get to preach four times today. So I'm looking, my voice is up for it too. And so... Let me ask you a question here. What's in a name? How much power is there in a name? You know, there's actually a field of study, and it's a name about this long, so I won't try to pronounce it, of studying names and the power that names have over us. But I want to share a couple with you here that I've run across. There was a man named John Payne. What kind of profession do you think he went into? A doctor. He became a doctor, John Payne. And Janice, actually, when we lived in Virginia, had a doctor named Dr. Hurt. I said, man, either go to another doctor or get him to change his name. But think about this one. Tell me what field of study or a profession you think he went into. Prince Fielder. Baseball player. Fielder, fielding baseballs. Here's another one. Derek Kickett. Soccer, Australian style football. Here's one probably you've heard of before. Usain Bolt. He's known as the fastest man alive. He can run like a lightning bolt. Guess what kind of doctor this is? Dr. Toothaker. You got it, a dentist. And then figure out what kind of doctor this is. Dr. Ovary. Figure that one out, okay. But, you know, you start thinking of all of these names, and I don't know how far you carry that type of thinking, that the power a name has over you, whether your identity is found in that type of name, I don't know how far it goes. But I do know that our identity has a great deal of power over who we are, what we turn out to be. Last week we said this, when you know who you are, you will know what to do. When you know who you are, you will know what to do. And we're at the conclusion of our study, God's Not Dead, and where we've been going through that now probably for 6 or 7 weeks. And a couple of weeks ago, I asked that question, well, if God's not dead, then why are we living like he is? And then we began to talk about, then why are we still struggling with the same sins and the same things that just get us down and cause us trouble? And why are we struggling still to find our walk, our identity in the Lord and walk with him? You know, just why? And we spent some time talking about this diagram. This has become a lot to me, this diagram with the... And we pointed out that our relationship with God, the kingdom of God, salvation, the gospel, has two different directions. You have the vertical, the up and down. That's what takes place between you and God and God and you. You know, that's where God reached down to us, sent his son. That's where we reached up to him and said, please save me from my sins. And the relationship was made. But there's also the horizontal element of the gospel, the kingdom of God. And that's how we live out once we had a relationship or have a relationship with God. What happened between us and God, the vertical, determines what we do here. The horizontal between us and other people. How we're to live because of what happened vertically. And we determined our identity is in Christ. And I hope you took your cards and you had those somewhere this week where you looked at multiple times to remind yourself that's your identity. You are in Christ. And we used that letter that Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus called Ephesians, where he spent a great amount of time, the first three chapters of Ephesians, establishing their new identity, that they were in Christ. 12 times in that short book, he reminded them that they are in Christ. Ephesians 1:1 says this, and this is where we began last week. It says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. That's their new identity. Identity is huge. Who you see yourself to be, who you are, determines how you're going to live. I like this definition. A good definition of identity, what your identity is the truest thing about you. The truest thing about you. What is that you see yourself to be? Your identity, and it can even be a wrong identity. But if you, that's what who you see yourself to be, that's who you are in your eyes. Read of an experiment that was done where they got volunteers to come in, and they had Hollywood makeup artists come in and put a terrible scar on the face of these people, both men and women, and then they showed them the scar that they had put on them and said, we're going to send you out into public, and you're just going to interact through the day, and we just want you to take note of how of what happens today. And it says, take a good look at it, but we don't want you to look at it in the mirror. Don't touch it. Don't draw attention to it. We just want you to see how it goes. They all agreed that's what they would do. And then he said, well, okay, we've got a few more touch-ups to go on the makeup here. And little did they know, as the makeup artist was working, they actually took the scar away. And their face was just back to normal. And these people went out, spent the day, then came back and reported. Every person that went out and came back said people treated them different. They stared at them. They weren't as friendly as people are usually to them. They were rude to them, or they weren't helpful. They said that I found I had no self-confidence. I wouldn't make eye contact with people. I kept my head down a lot of the time because of the scar. And there was no scar. What we think, what our identity, what we perceive our identity to be has great power over us. That's why the Bible takes so much time establishing our identity in Christ, getting that right, establishing this, the vertical, before it moves on to this, how we're supposed to live. And after establishing that, Paul, in writing in Ephesians, makes a switch to how you're supposed to live. And make no mistake about it. Don't make this mistake thinking that the vertical is the only thing that's important. If the vertical was the only thing that's important in the kingdom of God, then Jesus wouldn't have spent so much time talking about the horizontal, how we're supposed to live here, how we're supposed to interact. And if you think I'm exaggerating about that, go back and just read. Read portions of the Bible, the New Testament, the writers, Paul and Peter and John, James, Jesus, all of these things, and you'll see they spent over half of their time talking about the horizontal. Our identity flows into how we live. Let's go to the book of Ephesians again. Ephesians, we'll jump around there in Ephesians 4, 5, and 6. But that's where we're going to stay the whole time. The scripture will be on the screen. And I'm going to read from the New Living Translation today. So if it's not exactly like what you're following along with, that's why. Ephesians 4, 1 says, therefore I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. That word worthy. You know, we sing, Jesus is worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. He was the one who met the standards. He was the one who could die. But what does it mean for us when it talks about us living a life worthy of that? I tried to read and find the best definition. I ran across this. Worthy for us is the correct or appropriate response to what's been done. What's been done for us, the correct response, how we respond. For instance, this, if someone gave you a tremendous gift, sacrificed and gave you a gift, gave you a brand new car, and you just went, huh, car. No thank you, no smile, no nothing. Would that be a worthy response based on the gift that you had received? No. And Paul says here, live a life worthy of what's been done for you. Seeing what's been done for you, the vertical, and then have a proper response here in the horizontal life. You remember the movie Saving Private Ryan? I just assume everybody's watched it, and everybody, it's one of their favorite movies because it is one of mine. But in Saving Private Ryan, Tom Hanks is playing the lieutenant, and towards the end, he's dying, And he looks to Private Ryan and he whispers, "Earn this. Earn this." In other words, what he's saying is, look, myself, my men, we died to save you. Now don't go waste your life. Live a life worthy of what was just done for you. Pretty good example of what we're to live. Go to verse 2, Ephesians 4:2. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. How do I know when I'm not living a life worthy of my calling? It's when I'm not very humble, when I put myself ahead of other people, and then I know I'm not living a worthy life. How do I know? It's when I'm harsh with people, when my words and my deeds, whether it's with somebody I love or a total stranger in a store or in a line somewhere, that I'm harsh, then I know that I'm not living a life worthy. When I'm impatient instead of being patient with the people around me or even with God, that's when I know I'm not living up to my calling. Go to verse 20. Skip down to 4, verse 25. Chapter 4, verse 25. So stop telling lies. And you see what we're going here. Paul has transitioned from the vertical, what's happened here, who you are. He's saying, now this is how you're supposed to live. Because of this, this is how you're supposed to live here. Verse 24, 25. So stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we're all parts of the same body. God does not lie. God tells us that, plus he models that. So we're saying, why are you going to lie? You're a child of God. You don't lie. And how could we live a horizontal life reflecting being worthy of a God who does not lie if we're telling lies throughout our life? He says, don't do that. Verse 26 and 27. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. For anger gives a foothold to the devil. Don't we do some dumb things when we're angry? Think about some of the dumbest things you've ever done, and most likely it was when you were angry. My computer, I didn't do it, but my computer one time years ago was acting up so bad, and I remember I said, if I wasn't afraid, so sorry and afraid of what the people would say about me, I would carry it out there and put it in the middle of 17 and watch a truck run over it. You know, but you're angry. You know, you're angry. We do some hurtful things when we're angry. Go on to verse 28. If you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good hard work and then give generously to the others in need. God's not a thief, so we're not to be a thief. God worked hard, so we're to work. We're to contribute. We're not to be selfish. We're to make something so we can help other people. And we do our best to get to that place. Some of us can't get to that place because of some limitations, physical or mental or whatever. But we can't get there. But we're not to be a thief. How could you live out a life here stealing things? How could you live it out reflecting God, living a life of stealing? Verse 29, don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. I heard this story this week from a preacher that someone from his church went off to college, and the first day in a speech class, the professor, an impromptu thing, he says, you got to give up and give a so many minute talk on your favorite curse word. Your favorite curse word. So the students began to get up and have to talk about their favorite curse word, whichever one you say it. And as it went through, it came to this young man who came out of his church. And when it came to him, he said, I don't have a favorite cuss word. And the professor says, well, sure you do. Everybody does. He says, I don't, because I don't cuss. He says, everybody cusses. He says, I don't. He says, because of who I am. His identity. And he said later on through the class, you come to find out this professor, she believed in reincarnation, and she believed she was a squirrel in a past life. I think identity tells you some things, don't you? That where you think you came from establishes kind of how you live and see things out here. Paul moves on to another area. Turn to chapter 5, Ephesians 5, verse 3. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. To the people at Ephesus, this had a big meaning because there in Ephesus was the temple of Diana, known around the world. And part of the ritual, part of the religion was to offer sacrifices to the fertility gods. And you would go and literally pay your money to a temple prostitute, and you would have sex there at the temple. And this was to please the gods. And Paul is saying, no, not anymore. You may have done that, but you're a Christian now. You're a follower of Christ. You have an identity in Christ. No more. Don't do that. I don't care if your neighbors are doing it. You're not doing that anymore. Don't do that. Did you know there is a website, and I hesitate to tell you the name of the website. Somebody told it to me, and I didn't believe them, so I looked it up. AshleyMadison.com. Their motto is, life is short, have an affair. And they will hook you up with people in your area that you can discreetly meet and have an affair. Forget that website I just told you. Okay. But it's true. It's there. What these people are doing as looking at their desires through the lens, or looking at faith through the lens of desires. And they're making, I left off a big part. They say that 25% of their members identify themselves as Christian. 25%. And these 25% are looking at their at faith through the lens of their desires. Everybody knows what this is. Binoculars, you've always used them. And you know what good they have when you look through them, but we've all played around it sometime and turned them the other way and looked through the other side. And you know, it just doesn't work. It makes things worse. And what people are doing, people like this, is that they were looking at their faith through the lens of desire, where Paul is telling us, no, no, no. You look at your desires through the lens of faith. You get that straight. You look through the right end, and you will see things the right way. Then over in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21, he says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. After setting the foundation of everyone is equal to everyone. Right here it is, submit to one another. He goes into what is a controversial area for a lot of people, where he talks and says, wives, submit to your husbands. The husband is the head of the marriage. And he turns around. By doing that, he puts the burden of leadership and sacrifice on the husband. That's offensive to people in our day and time, to say a wife is to follow the lead of a husband. Some find that very offensive. But he told those men in the same teaching, he says, since you're the leader, you're to sacrifice everything for everybody else. You're first in the line of battle. You're the first to sacrifice. You're to love your wife like Christ loved the church, and that means you're willing to die for her. That's offensive to some people. But what's interesting is when Paul said this over 2,000 years ago, it was equally offensive then for the exact opposite reason. Because men would say, are you kidding me? You love your wife that much? And that was unfathomable then, because you didn't look at women that way. So they were offended then, where women are offended now. But the point is, once again, you're to honor God, honor the church. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to read anymore here, but I just want to mention the one, he goes over there and mentions children and parents. Children, obey your parents. Why? He says, because it's right. You're in the Lord. He says, parents, don't exasperate your children. Don't frustrate them. He says, raise your children with that vertical thought in mind for them. Raise them in the Lord. He addresses even slaves and masters in their relationship. And finally, Paul says in chapter 6, he says, defend this lifestyle with your life, with everything. That's where he goes in. He says, put on the full armor of God. Remember that? He says, defend this lifestyle with everything you've got. Now, that's a quick tour through four chapters of Ephesians. But one verse I want to share with you, I think, sums it all up. Ephesians 5:1 says this, Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children. Right there sums it all up. I want to share a short story with you here that I've told before, but it had a tremendous impact on me. Fred Craddock is a preacher out in the Midwest, teaches at a Bible college, and he was on vacation with his wife, and they came to Tennessee, and they stopped at a restaurant. And like a lot of local restaurants, you have people who are regulars. They weren't regulars, but saw a man going from table to table, and to be honest with you, Fred said, "I hope he doesn't come to our table. I just want to sit here with my wife and eat our dinner." But sure enough, he stopped by their table, and I said, Who are you folks? Where are you from? And what do you do? And Fred told him he was a professor at a college. He said, "Oh, so you teach preachers how to preach." And he grabbed a chair and slid down and said, I got a preacher story for you." And Fred was like, "Oh, man." And the old man sat down and he says, "I was born not too far from here in these hills. But I was born without a father. Never knew who my daddy was." He said, "So my mom and I, we had it pretty rough. I got the stares in town that you always got. I had some mighty mean things said to me at school and about in school. Said children were mighty bad." He said, "So I didn't have a lot of friends," and said, "I pretty much kept to myself." He said, "But I did love going to church. And I would slip into the church after everybody was seated. And I'd come in and sit down and I'd listen to the preacher." He says, "But at the end, I'd get out before the preacher could get to the back door, so I never had to speak to anybody, because I didn't want them asking or looking at me and knowing who I was." He says, "But one day they had a revival, and the preacher was preaching, and I'd sneak in and I'd hear him, and I'd sneak out the back." He says, "He preached one time, and something happened. I got blocked. I couldn't get out, and I got caught right in that line to go through and shake hands." He says, "And as I got to that preacher, he looked down at me and put his hand on my shoulder. He says, 'Wait a minute, whose boy are you?' And he said, 'That world closed in on me again, that I can't even go to church and escape this. The looks, the questions, the stares.' He said, 'I can't even go to church.'" He said, "That old preacher said, 'Wait a minute, I know who you are. I can see the resemblance. You're a child of God. Now go out and live it.'" He spanked him on out and sent him out. That old man said, "I never got that. That's the best piece of advice I ever got." And he got up and slid his chair back in. He told him his name. He said, "My name's Ben Hooper. It's been nice talking to you." And he walked away. And Fred Craddock sat there, and Ben Hooper, Ben Hooper, Ben Hooper. He said, "I remember from my history of studying Tennessee that Tennessee had elected a two-time governor of an illegitimate child of a two-term governor, Ben Hooper." Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children. You are a child of God. Let's live it that way. Let's have a word of prayer, and we're going to sing our hymn of invitation. God, help us live. Help us to live who we are, to see who we are, and let that be the thing that just drives us to live a life worthy of what you've done for us. Help us to know we're a child of God. Help us to claim our inheritance and then to live for you. If you will help us there, we will see a difference in our communities, in our churches, in our families, as we're living for you and no longer for ourselves. If there's somebody here today who needs to make a decision for Christ, I pray that they will. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.